Mae'n gweithio. Cwyr yr yma. Dylwch y lawr. Mae'r oed yn leil. Mis am bwyr yn ymwneud. Warm, warm Pacific greeting. And I think we are going to be graced with the rain that pours so generously on Tamaki Makaurau. So it's a real, it's really, what I'm wanting to is a lot of things. And you know, Bronwyn, just how much I connect with so much of what you're talking about. I will have a chance tomorrow to use one of your quotes when I'm at the Pacific Radio New Zealand is there around things. I think that 10 years thing is a really important one. I've talked about it a lot in terms around the human rights one, but I think it's so important, particularly in terms of the women that are out there. And I guess I just want to very, very quickly give a sort of a sense of my own learnings. I didn't come to university till I was 30 years old, but prior to coming to university, I had been very, very lucky in really where ignorance had got me. It took me quite a long way for that, really. So I grew up in South Auckland. I worked, my first job was at the airport, out at the Auckland airport. I waitressed out there, it's a brilliant job. I started at 5 in the morning, I loved that job. I did that for years. I thought that I'd go to the United States, do a pilgrimage of all the music I loved and had already worked out my pilgrimage when I was 17 years old. I was talking to someone who worked at the, you know, some people at the airport, and there was UTA, which was at that time the long distance French airline. Told me about my neat pilgrimage plan. I do the decoy through the US, following my musical loves. And he just looked at me and went, "You need culture." And he said, "You must go to France." And truly, virtually on that, having no French, having no sort of understanding of it, not knowing anyone in France, I thought, "Oh, yeah, it's a good idea." And I went back to my parents. I said, "I don't think I'll go to the US now. I think I'll go to France." And they went, "Oh, yes." That's truly, that was our sort of extent of it. So I ended up going to France. I'd never seen snow before, I'd never seen a whole range of things before. I went into a place that was very unusual to me, and I think a lot of my learning started there. I stayed in France actually for quite a number of years, but I guess the most significant thing is that I then went to Central Africa, to Burundi and to Rwanda. And this was prior to the genocide, so this was in the 80s. And it was really there that I really started to think about colonization. I was seeing the impact of colonization. It was a very different one than the one that I knew, and I started to think about how much I knew that. I thought I had quite a strong understanding of it. I came from, you know, I'm, as Joe said, I'm Tūhoe through my mother, and I'm Westfield Frizingworth through my father. And Westfield, in many ways, the way that those two things were embedded is so, so strong. So we had a very strong working class background coming out of South Auckland, but a very political one as well. My mum was involved in a whole range of different things, and my father was a very strong unionist. So it wasn't that colonisation at all hadn't been approached, it had, but I was trying to make sense of it in looking at what was happening in Burundi and Rwanda. And it made me really think, maybe I need to get an education. Maybe I actually do need to do something like that. Anyway, it still was a long time from then. I went from Burundi to Rwanda to Tonga, as you do. You can see that that's a very easy one. So I lived in Tonga for a number of years. Didn't want to live down in Nuku'alofa, so I lived up in the beautiful, beautiful, up in the Afu. And from Tonga, I went to Fiji. And from Fiji, I finally came back. So I did my first 7 papers by distance through Massey University. And so I really had that connect, and I went back when I got a BA, then I got an MA, and I went and worked at the University of South Pacific while I was doing my PhD. Though I actually wasn't doing my PhD, but I was enrolled. then I came back to Auckland. So you know, I think that I've been really privileged in terms of the people that have taught me, and the much broader spectrum of life. I've been really privileged to have spent the time that I have spent in the Pacific. And what I learned then, when I first went to Tonga, I had my first child. So it's just such an incredible place to be as a young mother with a baby in the Afu. Truly an incredible thing. But again, a very strong part of my education. By the time I started university, I had more children, but I was a single parent. And so the need for education, I think, became even more significant. So I'm wanting to first talk first about teaching as transformation, and I want to then get on to the women in prison. So I guess one of the things is that all teaching, all research must be transformative in intent. You know, by shaping and delivering teaching, we learn this incredible thing about what we bring from it, that students can, you know, what we're wanting to do in ourselves and with others is conceive of ways of transforming that world and that condition. In 2012, I was the, Guyon was referring to it, I was the co-chair of the Children's Commissioner's Expert Advisory Group on Child Poverty. We, you know, we wrote over 200,000 words. He's quite correct. You know, we did make a thing, and we've made it very clear in terms of what we do believe the number should be and why we do need to monitor against it. But he is right. The big thing is we know all of this stuff. There's no use now just constantly debating whether it's 150 or 250,000, whether it's those in severe material deprivation or those who are suffering persistent poverty or those who are going in and out of it. The fact is we've got it. We've got far too great a tolerance for it. Yeah. That there are communities and solutions absolutely at hand. People in this room have solutions to dealing with it. Some of it's around mitigation, but some are truly engaging with it. Poverty is not a part of our natural condition, it's part of our social condition. We made it, we can unmake it. So a lot of that is around that sort of real transformative element. And at the base of it, it is around, I think, relationships and the nature of the relationships that we've got. Where when we can sustain these relationships that we're able to generate and share knowledge, but also critical in thinking about new knowledge production, that we generate new knowledge. One of my always concerns is around, particularly with the adult learner, and particularly with the adult learner in literacy and numeracy, is the infantilization of that learner. And I think that the importance of recognizing the base from which someone comes, that we recognise the strengths that they bring with it. You know, Joe was talking about people, you know, that strong oracy, for example. What do they bring to it? You know, that's what the women out at Woody have taught me, is what they come there with. So, I guess, from a Māori perspective, I think from a Pacific's perspective, doing well, educationally, economically, and socially, is intrinsically linked to being well physically, culturally and spiritually. I also think that as a secular society, as a secular state, New Zealand has a particular responsibility in thinking about and reflecting upon its educative roles, its teaching and learning responsibilities. I believe that teaching and research can be conceptualized and actualized as one of the most powerful, if not the most powerful tool for decolonization and Māori and Pacific advancement. So I actually didn't read a lot of other people's work today, so I just want to get a little bit into that space before I get there. So I've said this in a lot of places, and forgive me if you have heard me say it before, but prisons, they colonize our landscapes, geographical and social, and for far too many, and particularly for far too many Māori, they colonize our future. So the crisis of Māori imprisonment is sustained and embedded. It's a crisis whose rupture runs deep in our whānau, in our communities, but largely remains indiscernible or normalised to mainstream community. So Angela Davis, an African-American activist and scholar, knows that on the whole, people take prisons for granted. It is difficult to imagine life without them. And that's one of the things I do in one of my classes on incarceration, that I say right from the very beginning, we shut the prisons today. We don't incarcerate, we decarcerate. What does that mean at a societal level? What happens when you do those sorts of things? And people's response to it, they truly cannot imagine it. Prisons create cognitive restriction. They absolutely destroy our ability to imagine another way of being, another way of world. We only see the prison. We think of punishment, we think of prison. All societies have social harm. We need to address social harm. The idea that there is this causal relationship between crime and punishment is absolutely not even borne out by the evidence. We've seen a falling crime rate for the last 20 years. We've tripled our incarceration rate. So prisons are invisible. But they're not invisible from headlines. They're not invisible as a metaphor of society gone wrong. They're not invisible as a solution to our problems, not invisible as the most overt manifestation of state power, as architectures of control. So they are invisible as receptacles of confined experience, as institutions of stone, of concrete, of wire. Yes, indeed they are. But much more than that, they are the holders of flesh and blood. And they are people. We often talk about prisons as if they are not people. They are people. In this country, they are largely holders of Māori flesh and blood. And going even deeper than that, they are holders of particular veins of Māori society. So this warehousing of surplus humanity in prisons, the ongoing carcerisation of Indigenous communities, both nationally and internationally, is largely a silent crisis that has resulted in the profound unfreedom for Māori and other Indigenous peoples. We have to be very clear, mass incarceration in Aotearoa New Zealand is Māori incarceration. And mass incarceration can be said to occur when the rates of incarceration impact negatively on sectors of society and communities, both inside the wire and outside of the wire. That's when mass incarceration happens. You keep taking a whole lot of people out of a community. And there are communities that I can name, but I'm not going to name, where the percentage of people who are removed from that community to incarceration impact in terms of what that means for farming. So that disproportionate members of a community are behind the wire, the conditions for cumulative and intergenerational disadvantage are extremely significant. The reach of the prison intergenerationally, socially, culturally is extremely high in this country. As I said, I believe that New Zealand, you know, very high incarceration rate, even against the countries we usually like to compare ourselves with, even in comparison with Canada and Australia as other settler states, though the US is truly the outlier there in terms of it. So mass incarceration impacts not only those who are behind the wire, but also the whānau and communities they come from. Elliot Curry notes, and I'm quoting him here, the prison has become a looming presence in our society to an extent unparalleled in our history or that of any other industrial democracy. Short of major wars, mass incarceration has been the most thoroughly implemented government social program of our time. We spend $1 billion a year. Yeah. $1 billion. Think about what the fiscal envelope is on settlement claims. So we spend $1 billion this year, we're going to spend $1 billion next year, and we'll spend $1 billion next year. Some members say that actually the prisons will work, particularly with the three strikes law, around extinguishing whakapapa. So, the last years, 9 years, I've been, and I had worked in prisons prior to this, but in the last 9 years, I've been particularly working with incarcerated Māori girls, and I use the word girls advisedly, 16 to 18 year olds, not in youth justice, in the adult prison. And young Māori woman, 18 to 25, actually that's been considerably extended, so a lot of them actually are older, but still my vast majority of them fit within between the 16 to 23, 24. While I'm mindful of the singularity of their actual experience of imprisonment, also interested in the broader notions, the social notions of their confinement, so that many of the they have come from where confinement of a different sort has already been an element in their lives. So I'm just going to get this started. I've got. That will just play along, and it's particularly, you know, I'm just wanting us to reflect some of the poetry of the woman will come up. But, you know, this is even as you, those of you who are flying today, depending on what side of the plane you're on, you'll actually see the prison. And I mean, we in Wiri, well, in Manukau, we have our first real precinct, carceral precinct, because we have the women's prison, as you see it here. We have the men's prison, the new men's prison, 920 men in that prison. And we have the youth justice residential. And they all together, they actually go right onto each other. When they were building the men's prison, quite a lot of my women were quite excited. I said, it's not like they're building another high school, you're not going to have dances. but you know, when you look down at the prison, this is what it looks like. You never get a sense of people in it. You know, and even when I look down, every time I fly, I look down at them. I know these units so really well, you know, in terms of high security, which we're looking at there. You know, right through, and yet when you look, you hardly see anyone in it. And I think that's, you know, we drive past, those of us in Auckland, past the prison, many of us every day. And again, the sort of sense of how they are people. What is in there? What's the experience? And just the collectivity of the experience of those who find themselves in prison. really links to actually what you're saying, Brian, in terms of both poverty, marginalisation, racism, all of those elements as the drivers of moving them in. So the people that I meet within the prison, they're young women, they come out of communities. The younger they are, the much more likely they are to come from small communities and rural New Zealand. They're not from the big cities, from small town and rural communities. They are members of whānau, they have iwi connections, and have intimate and complex ties that link them to places, histories, to people. Too many of them have had their lives marked by violence and suffering and living under very significant conditions of scarcity and deprivation. And the abundance they have had in their life has largely created negative outcomes. They have had social harm done to them, and many of them more recently have enacted social harm on others. They are victims that have in many cases reproduced victims. And this notion that we have offenders and victims, as if these are two discrete categories, of course, is an absolute myth, and it's very clear when you look at the evidence. However, their violence is a familiar, violence is one of my areas I work in, and known, and their relationship and understanding of violence is deep and nuanced. They are experts of their own condition, and in the piece of work I'm doing at the moment, they are actually the experts who are developing the concepts that we're going to use in an all-population violence study. Their experience and knowledge of incarceration usually significantly predates their own confinement. Again, for far too many, they're treading a well-worn path that many of their whānau, neighbours and peers have already taken. So I just give a real sense of just looking at the women now. Mostly the men I work with are ex-prisoners, and the women that I work with are usually in prison. It's a life course research approach, so you stay for the life course. And the commitment to the life course development is a critical aspect. So I work with women from all backgrounds, but just, you know, we all know, I think, I always say it's the most non-social statistic in New Zealand that over 50% of the prison population is Māori. You know, we know about the sheep, and we know about that. And we're usually wrong about the sheep. But if we look at it for women, it's actually far more marked. So over 65% of women who are in prison are Māori. And if you look at it from 16 to 25, about 92% of all women who are in prison are Māori. It's a very, very Māori environment when you're in the prison. So I just want to get a few little notes before I start talking about the work. With very few exceptions, all the young women who I've met over the last 7, 8, 9 years have been excluded from the compulsory education system by the age of 13. By the age of 13. They haven't got, you know, so this is so pertinent in terms of that 10 years. Mm-hmm. All right. You know, now let's just also think about those conditions of exclusion. And I think it's one of the really good examples when you can see that you can have good policy that creates bad outcomes. So an exclusion, you know, all of us understand this as parents of children here, why we would want our schools to be drug-free and violence-free. All of us can understand that. We can understand why you would have a policy that would support schools being violence and drug-free. However, through exclusion policies, largely related to those two issues, we are denying the human right of an education to far too many of our young people, and it's already intergenerational. So the youngest I've had of a child that was excluded was 6. Now, excluded, it's an exclusion from the education system. Now, if you're in Auckland, or if you're in Christchurch, or Dunedin, or Wellington, and you're excluded from the mainstream or the compulsory education system, it is likely that there'll be a range of options for you. The quality of those options will be very uneven, but there is likely that there will be some options for you. You imagine that you're from small town New Zealand. You imagine the types of options that are available for you. And it's one of the reasons the younger you come in, the more likely you are to be from small town New Zealand. And there's other reasons as well. New Zealand's very interesting in terms of its gang culture, and that's another area that I work really strongly with. In fact, I've got 3 days at Waitangiomata Marae this weekend with some of our gang whānau, looking at anti-violence strategies that they've been developing themselves. But whereas in many other parts of the world, gang formation is largely a large urban engagement, in New Zealand it's not. It's most pervasive in small towns. And many of you come from those small towns. where it is most pervasive. Some of you come from some of those original towns where that formation had. And I've written elsewhere around the role the state has played in gang formation, particularly with the confinement of children. From 1950 to 1990, this country incarcerated 100,000 people under 17. And places like Ipuni Boys Home, really was absolutely, particularly for the Mangoma, that's very, really so closely associated, just how important. So I have looked at their real state involvement in gang formation. So I'm very aware of the time. What time am I supposed to finish?
Someone when you finish.
Tell me. But anyway, I just want to... So I guess I'll just focus on that work in the prisons. And one is around education and creative writing in prisons. And I think that this has been the most astonishing thing. When I first went back in, it was largely because we had these young 16-year-olds. They're in an adult prison, but they can't be released, they can't be unlocked at the same time as adult prisoners until they're 18. And because there's far fewer of the women, you might have up to 30 under-18s within a men's prison. You know, the way that we should be lamenting that, of course, is incredible. But in a women's prison, you can have far less. But they had a number of young people, and they were driving each other mad. And they said, you know, will you come and devise a program, an educational program for them? So I came in with them. And that was 9 years ago. One of those young women I still see every Friday. You know, we have a number of young women who were given sentences that were longer than they had stood on the planet at the time they were given them. Those 17 years non-parole periods when they were under 17 at the time. Devastating reasons why they were in there, and I don't want to trivialise why they were in there either, because that's devastating for the whānau who lost members. So one of those I'm still seeing, actually all of those, I've got another three of them I've seen through that whole time. And really disturbingly, last week a young woman came in who I met when she was 16, she's come back at 22 and she's got 12 years. So the educational side, it would be NIA, it would be NCA, it would be a whole range of things, but what I found so quickly, and we always used to laugh about it, the things they've sort of hated the most, school and prison, I brought together. And I have constantly been astounded by what they produce and what they are able to do. I mean, it's an astonishing element, and it's an indictment on our society. It's an indictment that we see this, you know, people often say, oh, it's brilliant, how fantastic. Some people even seem to suggest what a great, you know, oh, what a great opportunity. But what, behind the why? It's not a great opportunity. If we see this, you know, it's around our lost opportunities, that the amount of human wastage that occurs because we haven't done what Helen and I said, and get on to it, 0 to 5, 5 to 10, 10 to 15, that's where all about our investment should be going. $1 billion we spend on a justice reinvestment, would reinvest that back into the communities so that they can absolutely flourish. And I've seen many of the initiatives that are working out there. So just getting those sort of, the education experiences prior to the exclusion were overall very poor. All women I've worked with that have experienced high levels of social harm, characterised by violence, including sexual violence. And it is the, I'll let that, and that may, we can maybe have a little bit of a discussion, but I just want to talk about some of the women. And I have used, I have given them other names, but they themselves will not mind that. There's a range of reasons, obviously, for doing that. So Araha. Araha is serving a life sentence. She's been incarcerated since she was 16. And was given a 17-year non-parole period. With her, that was reduced on appeal to 13 years. So she will do 13 years, she will have her first parole after 13 years. She's served 7 years now. She's now very unlikely to be released on that first parole, very, very unlikely. And it's likely she will appear a number of times before the parole board. I met someone the other day who appeared 13 times before the parole board. She suffered sexual violence from a very young age and was removed from her home and put into state care. Unfortunately, these placements did not remove her from violence. The impact on her education was marked, and she'd been excluded by the time she was 12. Immediately prior to the crime, and that put her into prison. She was in an extremely violent relationship where she suffered a head trauma. Her drug use was largely an attempt to escape the day-to-day realities of her life. When I first met her, and it was, we always talk about it now, she was in a very large group of young women. And it was clear that she found it very difficult to engage, and it was clear that she was super sussing me out in terms of why I was there. So yeah, she had very serious trust issues. That's a rational response to the conditions that she had that she had emerged from. But it was also clear that she had this astonishing curiosity of the world in general, and a very, very keen intelligence. She found it difficult to work in group situations. This was also in terms of her own circumstances. But she had this real interest in world history, and we started to look at the ancient world up to the contemporary issues in the modern world. We had a big, long time behind us. It's a different way, Bronwyn, of thinking about the word land. So she really demonstrated an incredible love for learning. In 2014, having never gone to high school, we were able to enroll her into an extramural student in Massey University, where she's now undertaking BA courses. She still does not have access to the internet or to any computer facilities throughout doing these courses, but I'm very lucky that I'm in a position that I'm able to supplement her course materials, and I'm able to tutor her in sections of that every week. For her first university paper, she received an A, and she received a B+ for the overall course. She had never sat an exam before in her life. She still finds the exams actually really overwhelming. But, you know, she still finds the whole process sometimes overwhelming, but she has persisted. Given that the time that she has in front of her, we will hope that she will have a degree either in hand or nearly completed by the time she comes up for parole. She recognises that her conviction will very much limit her opportunities, but she hopes to be able to make a contribution to the broader society. She is heartened by the fact that there have been a number of people in the last few years who, after serving life sentences, have gone on to serve the communities. And she's thinking about people like Dr. Rawiri Waratene Karena and Dr. Paul Wood. She's also serving as a role model for others, and I'm now supporting a number of other women who are undertaking university study. And actually three of them are undertaking university studies in Te Reo Māori. So I had to bring in people that could actually supplement that. Ranga Maria has an extensive criminal history. She's one of my older women. She's 37 years old, serving a 5-year sentence largely related to drug distribution. She served her first sentence as an 18-year-old in Australia for armed robbery and was deported back at the end of that sentence. And since then, she has served a number of prison sentences. She comes from a whānau that has very strong gang associations and who themselves have long histories of incarceration. In the past, on leaving prison, she has returned swiftly to the life she has known. She joined one of my creative writing groups. It was a particular group of more mature women, still relatively young women, but had very common experiences, particularly around drug addiction. And this writing group had a focus on writing ourselves whole. So she indicated an interest in writing a life story and trying to make sense of her motivations, decision making, and responses to her lived condition. She has written over 50,000 words and continues to write. And I'm going to read a part of her writing. I support her writing by editing and discussing her work, and I'm going to do her first day out, where she captures the obstacles that women face immediately on release. It is a powerful piece written in the third person that illustrates it. Really is in a movie sense, it's very cinematic form, what that day is like at the personal level. And I think I've got another one, Manawai also, who's also serving, another young woman who's serving a life sentence. I'm also going to use her work. When I first met her, she came in on her 16th birthday. She'd been in confined since 14. Youth Justice came in on her 16th birthday. And I remember we used to be doing NCA level one. And she would just put her head in her arms and just tell me, please make it stop. She just couldn't bear it, couldn't do the week. And that's really, for me, where Tupac has really became my saviour. The importance in hip-hop of the word has made the word very important to the woman that I work with. And even with one of my children, we had many disagreements about the decibel level of him playing Tupac, you know, back in the 90s, and also about the language and the misogyny. These were quite a range of issues that we had around those sorts of things. And you know, now I embrace Tupac with all of my heart. it's Tupac and a whole, I mean, people can sometimes see these things that I'm doing because I'm constantly working with lyrics. And they see the lyrics that I've got, the places that I've got my screens, so whilst I'm not street, I can be a little bit street. they're always correcting my language, actually, in terms of that. But with Manawa, it's just been incredible. After we went right up to level 2 NCA with her, but it was creative writing that absolutely brought her up. She was astonishing, as you will see. She's had really limited formal education. Amazing the wordsmith that she is. So finding a way to express herself, to articulate her fears, her remorse, her aspirations has been an incredible journey for her. She'll turn 23 very soon, and she's now my most prolific writer. The quality of her writing is astonishing, absolutely astonishing. She's gone from someone who struggled to write to someone who's compelled to write. And her poetic sensibility is just so incredibly finely tuned. The way she scans is astonishing. And she's interesting because she's also able to write in Te Reo Māori, and she does both of that. She's got a number of people that can support her in that. And she's my editor on this book. I'm going to read, if you'll allow me, I'll read these things and then I'll finish. I'll read a really simple one which just shows that beauty of the words, and this is why I say that we don't infantilize, we find the place that speaks to people, we ensure that the writing and numerous and what we're doing is mana enhancing. You know, people come from, you know, as human beings, we try to avoid shame, we try to accumulate pride. For far too many of these young women, they've grown up in conditions where it's very hard to accumulate pride. Mm-hmm. What they have taught me and what they continue to teach me in this area is just astonishing. But just get that sort of sense in terms of just the way she wrote this, just a beautiful word, two words to every line. Every heart falls apart, every tear falls with fear, every beat falls weak. Every thought battles fought, every mind falls behind, every crush ends in lust. Every drop never stop, every breath ends in death. Every touch loves too much, every life ends in strife. Every soul loses control, every light turns to night. Every friend always end, every pain comes again, and every heart falls apart. Astonishing, astonishing writer. And I'm going to read the first, and it is a little bit long, I might have to, because this is a piece of prose. Now, this is the first day out. When she wrote this, she'd had 7 first day outs. So what we've been trying to write about what the last day in would look like. Now, one of the reasons I won't be able to be here this afternoon is because she's out again, and she is working so astonishingly hard. She's living less than 2 km from where we stand now, and every day is hard. Every day is astonishingly hard. She had a week last week that I don't think any of us would have been able to get through. And she's just been astonishing, working through it. And, you know, I have such pride in her and what she's done. So this is called First Day Out. She gets released 1 year later, walks to Aro, happiest day of her life, walks through the reception and immediately sees there isn't anyone out front to pick her up. She's sad, but has the staunch mask on. She's been wearing it for the whole year. Inside, she's shattered, gutted, heart is broken. She takes a deep breath and sucks it up and starts walking towards the township. Cashes in her steps to freedom, $350, buys her babies a gift at the $2 shop and a packet of smokes and lighter. She's smiling now, feeling a lot better, jumps into the next bus, heading on her way home. She sees the grass hasn't been cut for weeks. Kids could have hidden in it. No one home. Strolls through the house, gate fever coming on strong and freaking out. She heads towards the kitchen and sees dishes stacked up with wheat bits and eggs, dried and crusty. Opens the cupboard under the sink to get the dishwashing liquid, and there is nothing in there but empty bottles. She walks to the bathroom, empty shampoo bottles and a crusty old piece of soap she thinks she remembers buying a year ago. It is down to the core. She sees mould in her bath, dirt ring, and it smells of piss. She wants to yell, but she's got used to dirty showers from jail, filled with girls' hair and old soap left in the drain. remembers she's not in jail and snaps back. She walks into the laundry and is still thinking how white her bathtub used to be. She's hoping there's Jip or Attaway in there, especially Attaway. It's been her favourite for a year, and her bath could do with the strong stuff. She pushes open the door to the laundry and just looks. The washing machine, gone. 5K dry load, just gone. She's thinking, has it broken down? And if it has, why? It looks like every piece of clothes her kids have ever owned has got fluffy mould growing on it and over the black rubbish bags with even more clothes spilling out and spewing onto the sides. It stinks and she notices a mouse jumping from the rotting rubbish bag in the corner. It sprints fast under her legs and she jumps. That's something she hasn't seen in a long time. She has an urge to catch it, just to have some company. She sees she hasn't got any Attaway or Jip, so she goes to check her lounge room and hopes that all the kids' photos are still on the wall safe. She saw her kids 10 months ago and nobody sent any more photos into her. She starts thinking they must be big and smiles sadly. Good, photos are there. She goes in and decides she wants to watch, turn the TV on. The TV is gone, just a broken radio. She had a better one in her cell. The tape is a bit broken off on the front and she pictures where the radio sat in her cell. She goes to turn this one on and there's no power. She's trying so hard to compose herself, blaming herself for going to prison, knowing that she should be there for her family. Tears start rolling down her face. Then she hears a little noise. It's coming from the kids' room. She creeps in, brushes the door open, and a cat jumps towards her. She thinks she must be having a heart attack when she notices there's a broken window at the top of the window frame. She shakes her head. She starts to remember back to when the house was for her, like her little house on the prairie, watery eyes filling, and just thought that's what she could do to him. She goes to her bedroom to get out of the clothes she got released in, tight and small because she's put weight on inside. As she's walking into the room, she notices a string type thing. It's bright pink. She thinks, I never had pink hair ties. But then she realizes that it's another woman's G-string. She saw a few of them in jail when the girls sat down on the steps and their pants were down. Their G-string sticking out. She's getting flashbacks and then hopes she has some class and starts thinking of the size 10 G-string she's just found. She's picturing some 14 plus squeezing her ass in it so tight that you see the string embedded in the ass cheek when she sat down in jail. Then she sees her clothes have been raided, knickers and bras gone. Had her thinking of a time when she had a fight inside because someone accused her of taking their bra. She's laughing to herself now because with the amount of undies, bras, and other things that are missing from her drawer, it would have resulted in a homicide compared to that one missing bra inside. She sits down on the bed, tilts her head back, no power, phone, cleaning products, food, TV, washing machine gone, mice, cat, rotten, stink, rubbish. She walks to the toilet and she pushes open the toilet door. Even before she's seen the toilet paper holder, she spots the yellow pages and knows instantly there's no toilet paper and wishes she had the sandpaper type of toilet paper you get inside every time you hand in your empty roll. She starts wishing she was back inside, but then she remembers her baby's crying at court. She heard them all the way from the courthouse, down the stairway to the holding cell in the courthouse on sentencing day, and how her heart was aching when the chubby security holding onto her arm escorted her. Anyone would think she was an absconder or an escapee. She walks out of the bedroom, goes for a walk around the house and sees a bottle of petrol sitting next to the lawnmower, rusted now like it's been in the rain for months. 50 rubbish bags leaning up against the house, mice and rat shit. She tries to picture the kids playing in the back of a state like this and wonders if Sifs have her babies. I'll just miss a bit here. She decides to catch a taxi to go to go where she thinks that her husband will be. They drive past the school on the way, and she wonders if the kids will be in there. She's passing her son's school and looks for him in case she spots him. She thinks, nah, can't be there. Father let their kids home go like that. He's going to send them to school, run down, mice infested, disgusting, and then he manages to send them to school. Hell no. The driver asks her, how's your day? Indian dude with the turban reminded her of an officer, Mr. Singh. Strict officer, quiet, likes to dance occasionally. She had a 2-second thought that this guy's the first person she's spoken to since she left jail this morning. She stopped drinking some years back, but she feels like buying a bottle and getting wasted, but she needs to focus and actually heads to the pub. Pub, please, she says to the driver. She's really not in a talkative mood and feels disrespectful, but wonders if she said, I just got out of jail this morning. Would he want to talk to her then? Probably not. He'd probably accelerate the car to get to their destination quicker. She smiles slightly. They pull into the car park and she spots her once decent car with a large ding in the front. It's just after lunch and the stereo is playing loud and the pokey machines are flashing their deceptive lies. She pops her head in and spots her so-called supportive husband, stone-cold drunk, off-balance, kissing a girl on the side of the face. As she walks to the bar, she watches her husband grab her ass and assumes they must have been seeing each other for a while. They look like a couple. People are staring at her, walking towards the loser, and she taps on the shoulder. There are going to be some expletives in this section. He spins around and doesn't notice her straight away, looks away and then looks back. The girl comes back, looks the wife up and down and says, "Who the fuck is this?" She puts down the glasses she is carrying and stares at wifey and says, "Yes, can we help you?" She doesn't say anything, except to her loser husband, holds her hand out and just says, "Keys, house and car." Girl pipes up again and says to the wife, "Bitch, fuck off." The husband hits the girl so hard she falls off the stool onto the floor. As she falls, the wife spots a few bruises on her arms and legs and notices under the makeup of her face that she has a faded black eyes. He hands his wife the keys and she just takes them and walks out of the pub. He looks down at the girl crying and watches his wife walk away. She could hear him yelling at the new missus, "That was my wife, you stupid cow." She wonders why she stayed with him and thinks they never would have tolerated that shit. She would have been in jail for murder. She starts her car up and heads to his mother's to pick up the kids. So she is out now and she's doing astonishingly well, but I just for us to understand just how unbelievably hard it is. Day in and day out, and you've got to do that day in and day out, and then you get to 18 months and you've got to do it for the rest of your life. You've got to do it all the time. And the last one that I will leave you with is my beautiful young poet. I actually watched her write this. She just poured out of her. She was sitting on the ground. She hadn't seen me come up to her. I could see she was writing, so I thought I'd just wait till she finished. And then she finished, she just looked up, and it was just this astonishing thing. She said, "I just can't believe that you're here." And some ways it's very natural. I was there. It's Friday. I always go Friday, and then you always see her Friday. But it's because she's so in this place. And it's a hard poem, but it's just an astonishing poem. Called She Screams. She screams heartbreak and betrayal, yet no one even stopped. She screams heartache and capture, yet she was instantly dropped. She screams a mourning mother whose eyes are red from crying. She screams a soul of departure to avoid the fear of dying. She screams for honesty and love to cherish forever. She screams to God, "Please, please keep my mind together." She screams of lost hope and searches for one to confide. She screams for a shield so she can run and hide. She screams for answers and treasures to seek and find. She screams for acceptance, only to lose her mind. She screams a plight of blinded pain that everyone's too busy to hear. She screams silently and drowns in a thousand tears. She screams with high pitch enough to make you deaf. She screams and screams and screams till she has no breath. She screams with hurt and suffering, to some it may seem silent. She screams with rage and resentment till her mind runs violent. She screams for an ending to her misery and torment. She screams louder and louder till her heart turns to cement. She screams out loud, but quietly holds it in. She screams for acceptance to God for her committed sins. She screams her heart out till she can find him talk. She says she felt it all and found a road which alone she walks. This young girl, if you look at her sentence, if you look at her school reports, you would never been able to recognize from those reports the incredible ability that she has. And there's certain spelling mistakes that she always makes when you see within it. It's just an astonishing amount. And you want to see some of the other ones in terms of the way that language is used. And I think that is really important for us to think around language use and around the relevant and the importance of expression in any way that it falls. And I just read her PS. I found myself often questioning the past simply because I never really understood it. I've been feeling really confused and drift off to past events. My loved ones, my friends, my whānau, it all feels like I never really had that. I screamed out for years, and maybe it was that no one cared. Maybe it was that no one heard. Maybe it was that no one was truly there. So I walked that journey alone. I'm so angry, I'm so broken, but yet I'm walking my road. I'm facing my life, free or not. Kia ora tātou.